Carroll bringing it forward. Thompson's making the run. Carroll hangs on to it though. Still Davy Carroll could go all the way here. Oh, what a goal!
Hello, I'm Phil Catchpole and welcome to Ringing the Blues, the official Wycombe Wanderers podcast. Coming up on this week's show, we've got all the action and reaction from the games against Accrington, Stanley, Adams Park and the trip to Pride Park to take on Derby County. We speak to Dr. Bob Sangar, the Wycombe Wanderers match day doctor, to find out more about his role and also about an invention that he's been working on. But first, let's head to Mexico City to get the results with Uri.
We are ringing the blues from Mexico City. My name is Uri, and before giving the results for League One, let's wish my friend Phil Catchpole a very, very happy birthday.
Estas son las mañanitas que cantaba el Rey David.
That's happy birthday to you in a Mexican style. Now, back to the results. Accrington Stanley 1, Cheltenham Town 0, Bolton Wanderers 1, Peterborough United 0, Bristol Rovers 3, Lincoln City 6, Cambridge United 0, Barnsley 3, Derby County 2, Wycombe Wanderers 1, Exeter City 0, Burton Albion 2, Fleetwood Town 1, Charlton Athletic 1, Forest Green Rovers 1, Morecambe 2, Oxford United 1, MK Dons 2, Port Vale 2, Shrewsbury Town 1, Portsmouth 2, Plymouth Argyle 2, Sheffield Wednesday 2, Ipswich Town 2. Now, Cherbo Spanish, is it 3 at the back or 4 at the back? Okay, the literal translation would be, you know, let's first study numbers. 3, number 3, tres, number 4, cuatro, back, atrás. So, 3 at the back or 4 at the back, tres atrás o cuatro atrás. Okay, but that's not the translation we use in Mexican football. In Mexican football, we talk about line of three or line of four. So it would be línea de tres or línea de cuatro. Very easy this time, my amigo Phil Catchpole. Happy birthday again and back to Ingerland. Until next week.
Ah, cheers, Uri. Many thanks for the birthday wishes, everybody. And we have to say happy birthday to Uri too, because it was his big day on the 18th of September. So as we say here in London, happy birthday, mate. Right, Accrington Stanley at Adams Park. The first game up in the Bill Turnbull Gantry. Big thanks to Wycombe Sound and Landways for making it possible. The first commentary was with me and Steve Brown, one of Bill's favourite players. Here's what happened. Thanks, Luke. Welcome to Adams Park, live from the Bill Turnbull Gantry at the back of the Frank Adams stand for full match commentary of Wycombe Wanderers versus Accrington Stanley. Wingers come across as well, and now Mometi comes short, goes back to McCarthy, clips it down the line to Wing. Wing controls. Mometi takes over now on the right hand side, digs out across, looking for Bucks, he gets there. Yeah. Gets across his man, heads the ball into the turf. It was a comfortable save in the end, but a decent move, Steve.
Yeah, it was. You know, Mometi was definitely wanted the ball from the throw-in. He worked it with McCarthy down the right-hand side, gets the ball back, and then works across. A great delivery going away from the defender, which favoured the striker. So, you know, good attempt on goal.
Dominic Gate. Push. Oh, it's a lovely ball. McCarthy, through on goal. Narrow angle, takes a heavy touch. Oh, the beats the keeper. And Wycombe Wanderers, I believe, here in the rain. Jason McCarthy received the ball from Scowen. Yes! His first touch looks a little heavy. He drew the keeper and he slid it underneath the advancing Lucas Jensen. It's Wycombe Wanderers 1, Accrington Stanley 0. Great goal.
Yeah, great goal. And, you know, again, credit to Josh Scowen. I said earlier this game about second balls. It was a loose ball. Josh Scowen was quickly onto it and threaded it through the inside the centre-back and the left-back.
Gareth, the 1-0 win against Accrington in the rain under the lights at Adams Park, but a really good team performance.
Yeah, I thought so too, Phil. You know, I thought we were solid. We didn't look like we were going to get scored against. They had one really good chance, you know, where they put a cross in and I think Lowe or Lee, it was, got to it near post. Max was superb, you know, and I thought his handling, he's the way he manages the team in front of him, and his kicking was outstanding. But he had a great 10 in front of him, you know, a real 10. I don't want to pick anyone out today because everyone was superb. It was probably a Wycombe performance in the rain on a zippy pitch, you know, with a Tuesday night, you know, 2,000-4,000 fans here. That's all that we can, you know, we get for these games. And fair play to the Accrington fans, you know, for travelling all that way. I live up there. I know how far it is, but they were there for their team, and I'm sure that they'll get more points on the road because they're decent, you know, when they can't hurt you coming forward. But we didn't want to be hurt today, you know. The boys were drilled well this week. We changed shape slightly. Obviously, we went three at the back, and I thought it worked well. I think that, you know, looking at the footage with Josh earlier in the week, that's the way we wanted to have a look at things. And then Double Blooms come in. I told him what I wanted to do, and you know, together we all sort of verified that, you know, we thought that was the way that we could hurt Accrington. I thought first half, first 10 minutes, we were camped in their half, and then when they started chucking so much forward at us when we went 1-0 up, Anis seemed to be getting so much space, and then Ali when he came on, and I thought we could have added one or two more. Gapey's run through, just lost his legs, didn't he, in that last final bit. But loose wing, and again, you know, chances, and got Voxie right there, and it would have been great to cap that off. But no, really pleased. Good to have Voxie back. The legs have got to be rested now for Saturday because we've got a big game coming up at Derby. You've got beat today and not going to be happy about that. So, but really pleased with everyone today.
We had Steve Brown on comms tonight and unsurprisingly was purring about the central midfielders, Josh Goh and Dominic Gape. Fantastic tonight.
Absolutely, you know, and then Nick Freeman when he came on, I put another one in there because I thought they were just getting hold of the ball a little bit too much for me, and Nick did a job as well. So, but Dom and Josh, honestly, there's not two better midfielders in this league, I'm telling you. And if there is, they're probably here, you know, with Lewis Wing, Nick Freeman, Jack Young coming through, and you know, and Curtis Thompson. Wow, you know, I forgot about Curtis. He's been injured for a while. So we've got these midfield ratters because the way we play. They love, you know, I just said to Dom, I said, I thought you're outstanding. Dom covered every blade, and he said to me, I loved it, Gaffer. And that's great for me when they love playing this dogged way sometimes. We probably went slightly away from some of the flowing football we've played, but again, that was from me. I wanted to make sure the tactics were right to try and get at Accrington. They press you high, and we tried to get the ball forward as quick as we could to get in behind them, and it worked. Jason McCarthy's goal took really well. Brilliant to have him back in the team, and as is Sam Volks. Like I say, it's only one game. You know, John's a wily fox in this game. They'll get points on the road, believe me, and I consider that a good result against a management team that's nearly as long as me. You know, they've been together, so very, very big respect for Accrington.
Accrington, by my count, 11 corners, probably double figures in terms of long throws into the box as well. But the clean sheet will certainly please you after some of the troubles that Wycombe had in the earlier games of the season with set pieces.
Yeah, we worked hard on it, you know, and we brought them in a couple of afternoons working on that. We've watched Accrington extensively, and long throws and set pieces. They're a team that has had some stars in it, and you have to give John credit, you know. Deion Charles and Colby Bishop and you know, Pell and people like that, and Sykes, who's gone abroad. So they've had some real good players, and they have to sell. They always have to sell these players, and so John has to keep reinventing the team. And they've gone probably slightly away from flowing football that they used to play, and they've got these set piece specialists now as well, and they're dangerous. So, but I think that any team tonight would have struggled to play the way we pressed, the way the energy was in the team. I think the boys were a bit aggrieved at last week's equaliser, and they wanted to put a marker down tonight, and that's really good. But you know, safe trip home for Accrington. Like I say, a lot of respect. That's my part of the world. But really pleased we got the win.
Onwards to Derby. See you at Pride Park.
Cheers, mate.
Max, a 1-0 win, but from a goalkeeping perspective, a clean sheet. That must have delighted you.
Of course. I think that we wanted to win the game. I think our objective was achieved. We won the game. Obviously, clean sheet, and defensive performance from our team was brilliant today, and I think everyone seems to be happy today because of we could have, you know, they could have broken us down on the corners, set places and stuff like this, but actually we stood up and defended really well our box, so that's credit to all the team.
A big defensive display. It was 11 corners by my count, and I think maybe double figures in terms of long throws into the box, so a lot of defending to do as a unit.
I lost count after the first one, to be fair. No, I'm joking. Obviously, yeah, we knew what they are all about. We knew they're going to put physical battle into it. We knew they are about set pieces, throw-ins, corners, free kicks and stuff like this. So we prepared for that game really well. And I think, as you could see today, they really didn't really have much, you know, shots and chances to score a goal.
One great save in particular in the second half from you, from Wally. It was close range. Did you see much of it?
No, I just basically stood in a good position. And then the ball just hit me, so I was just happy to save it. And, you know, in a training I was laughing because I let like 3 goals like that in a training, and I was thinking in a game, sorry, 2 goals. So third time is lucky, so I saved it in a game, so that's good, really.
It's the first time we've spoken to you since the day you signed. How have you settled into life here at Wycombe Wanderers?
It's great. I'm really enjoying it, and obviously staff, facilities, everything is amazing. I'm really happy here. I just basically love coming into training, love playing games, and then hopefully soon I will find a place to live. But actually, like, I'm enjoying the area. I'm just settling fine for now.
And the fans on the terrace, is always a good relationship here at Wycombe between the home fans behind the goal. How are you getting on with those guys?
Well, fine, I bet. I don't know. As long as I'm keeping playing well and the team is performing, I think no one is getting a stick, you know. And I think obviously we had supporting, they come for away games and supporting, it's great. And then obviously we appreciate it as a team, and then obviously fans are important to us.
And while we got you on there, you're looking for somewhere to live in Wycombe, what do you need?
Ideally 2-bedroom house with a garden, but we'll see.
Okay, if anyone can help, Max, he's a lovely guy.
And I've got a dog.
Okay, and a dog as well. The dog's nice as well, right?
It's nice, but I'm not saying a breed.
Okay.
People will get scared.
Well played, Supermax. Right then, the Accrington Stanley fans travelled in fairly decent numbers, over 70 there on a wet Tuesday night, long way from home. Here's what some of them had to say after the full-time whistle. Mr. Turnbull.
I think I saw Matt Lowe feature in play just once after he came on. We're going down if we keep playing like this.
Quotes for life.
We won't go down. It's injuries. We've had several players from the first team out having to play young undeveloped players. We also had to play Tommy Lee up top, and he's a midfielder. We played well second half, and a draw was deserved. We've been robbed recently.
James Akimad.
Great second half. It's a shame we can't play with that intensity all game. And with 2 up top, Tommy Lee didn't win a single header up there. I'm not slagging him off, he's a great midfielder, but he could clearly do with a strike partner. Such a shame we gave a soft goal away in first half.
Richie Biscuit.
I'm not having McColville one bit. The game completely passed him by. He was at fault for the goal, and all his deliveries were piss poor.
Valerian.
When I saw the team and the fact that Darren Drysdale was in charge, I feared the worst before kickoff. And I appreciate we have injuries, but the team really lacks balance at the moment.
Exile on Spencer Street.
I thought it was a better performance than at Forest Green, but predictably the same result. Tommy Lee's undoubted skills were wasted running around up top on his own. And I can't remember Stanley getting anything from any of the many, many corners. Also, predictably, the poor refereeing from Drysdale. Coyle got a yellow card for being fouled. Hamilton was pushed in the back and fell on the ball and was penalised. Clark was shoulder charged down in the corner, and when he reciprocated, perfectly legally, the Wycombe player got a free kick for diving. It seems an established law amongst refs that Stanley's attacking players can be pushed and pulled with impunity.
Inspector Morse.
I thought we did okay last night. We probably were no blunter than for much of the season so far. Effort was there, and I thought, on points, we merited a draw. The pressure is on a bit now, though, especially if we lose on Saturday. Button down the hatches. It's going to be a long winter.
Oof, yeah, it's going to be a long one, isn't it? Right then, Derby County action and reaction coming up. But first, I spoke to one of my favourite people connected with Wycombe Wanderers, Dr. Bob, a very interesting guy. And we thought we'd find out a bit more about what he gets up to on a match day and also what else he does when he's not at football. Dr. Bob, we are in your room in the bowels of Adams Park. The music we can hear is coming from the home dressing room. But explain your match day operation. What's your average match day as the club doctor?
Yeah, so I'll generally on the day have a conversation with the physio staff to see if there's any particular issues that are going to need to be addressed for the game. Sometimes if players may be having some degree of sort of illness or something beforehand and they just need fitness testing, then I'll come in a bit earlier and check them over, make sure that they're all absolutely fine. And other than that, I'll arrive usually about an hour and a half before the game, catch up with everybody, make sure there aren't any other issues that need attending to, have a look, go through my equipment, do an equipment check, and then welcome the crowd doctor, the opposition medical team, and then liaise with the pitch side emergency staff, such as our wonderful paramedics. And then generally, sort of about half an hour, 40 minutes before kickoff, we'll then do an emergency action plan meeting with all of the emergency medical staff to make sure that everything goes smoothly, hopefully.
So you are an integral part of this game. So every professional football match in the country has a similar setup.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, I think it's fairly standard now in terms of how medical teams operate. There's a slight sort of differentiation between the crowd medical team and the pitch side emergency team. So there's, depending on how many fans there will be coming to a game, there's often a crowd doctor as well. And we often tend to have a regular crowd doctor here at Adams Park. It's a chap called Dr. Carl Wardman. It's a lovely chap. And then there'll be a paramedic team assigned to the crowd doctor as well, but we all work as one cohesive unit, and we try very hard to make sure that everybody knows what roles they're going to be taking up should something significant and unforeseen happen.
So if you were to have a medical emergency at a football match, it's probably not a bad place within society. There's a lot of medical cover here.
There is plenty of cover, although we would discourage anybody wanting some urgent medical attention to come to Adams Park in the first place. There's probably better places to get ill. But having said that, you know, we're generally fairly well prepared, as was unfortunately illustrated with the fortunate incident with Mr. Bird a couple of years ago. But actually, you know, everything that needed to happen actually happened, and it was extremely effective at the time.
How long have you been a club doctor here at Wycombe Wanderers?
So I'm coming into my fifth season now. I was very, very fortunate that in my first season we got promoted. The second season we survived, and then third season we got promoted again, and didn't manage to keep up the run for the fourth year, unfortunately. But you know, we can make all sorts of allegations that we were robbed at the time. But I think, you know, it's been a wonderful sort of distraction from the rigours of the NHS, you know, and through a very, very difficult time, and a very enjoyable experience overall, and it's really nice to be able to contribute.
And is this the first football team you've been involved with in a medical capacity?
Yes, it is, yeah. So I'd never done any football medicine work before I arrived here. And but then since then, you know, I've been fortunate enough to extend my repertoire of environments I've worked in. I've done a bit of work for Reading's Academy, and then I was fortunate enough to be asked to cover the Women's Euros games at Brentford, which is a real honour.
So this is really interesting, because we're going to move this conversation on now, because you've used your medical experience and now your football experience, and you're opening up another avenue to your, well, another string to your bow is probably the right thing, and you're now involved in shin pads. Explain to me a bit about this.
Yeah, so it probably doesn't escape anybody's attention that the modern-day footballer chooses to forsake sometimes what it's a very important piece of their kit. It's the only piece of protection that's actually mandated by the rules of the game. So all players are meant to go on with appropriate sort of shin pads. Some of them rather naughty and wear shin pads that sort of just about would fit a four-year-old. And others do all sorts of things like trimming down bits of yoga mat. I'd like to think that there aren't any characters like that here at Adams Park, but I can't pass comment beyond that. But so, you know, we're unfortunate enough that sometimes we see the consequences of a lack of adequate protection for our players. And a very close friend of mine who I used to play five-a-side football with had been involved previously with this amazing British company called Rion Labs. And, you know, we were having a conversation and we thought, actually, there must be a better way to do this. And that's what led to our conversation with Rion Labs, who are an absolute sort of world leader. And they have this amazing smart material, which was developed and invented by a very clever chap called Dan Plant at Imperial College. And they've spun that out into a company. And, you know, we're really quite fortunate and very excited that we're the first ever sort of company to pioneer something like this in world football. So, you know, and Adams Park and the players that we've got here at Wycombe Wanderers were kind enough to allow me to use them as a test bed, as it were, and the feedback's been excellent.
It's a podcast. It's very difficult to explain, though. I mean, I've seen and touched and felt these. Where can our listeners find out more and see what you're talking about with these shin pads? Because they are really quite something.
Yeah, so we've got an active sort of Instagram page where things are sort of getting posted out. But we've got a good website. It's www.smart-armour.com. And give us a follow on Instagram. We're on Twitter, although there's nobody following us really on Twitter, other than me or my mum maybe. but actually, you know, hopefully there'll be more coming out because you know, we're very excited that our players have recognised that this is a really interesting and unique product. And you know, we're going to be trying to see if we can promote this sort of culture of safety and you know, attention to detail within the British game.
It's a wonderful amalgamation of your life's experiences, isn't it? Because doctor, GP, NHS, into football, realised the problem and then acted upon it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, you know, the wonderful thing is that a club with a relatively flat hierarchy, with such an open and welcoming atmosphere, everybody is treated as being unique and capable of generating, you know, really fruitful ideas. And actually, it's places like this where sort of, you know, the sort of flair for British innovation and talent can still flourish. And, you know, had I not been in an environment like this, nothing like this would have happened. Had I not had a friend who had actually been in sort of contact and worked for this company before Rion Labs, I don't think we would have done this. And had I not been supported by the players and the staff, I don't think we would have done this. So, you know, it's just wonderful that actually little old Wycombe Wanderers, you know, is capable of doing things that are world firsts. And, you know, I'm very, very proud to have been involved.
Smart Armour shin pad sounding good. Sam Vokes wears them, and I caught up with him to find out why he likes them. Vokesy, Smart Armour shin pads. Alan, you've been wearing these for a few months, right?
Yes, yeah. Dr. brought them into the club. I've been wearing them for about 6 months, maybe Christmas last year. And I love them, to be fair. They're amazing.
Why are they so good?
I think it sounds stupid. It's actually quite hard to find a good shin pad that's comfortable, durable, and, like, to be honest with you, you don't even feel like you're wearing it. But we've gone through all the technology with them and they sound brilliant. So you've got the protection and yeah, you feel good, comfortable.
And it's got the Wycombe Wanderers link to it because it's Dr. Bob.
Exactly, Dr. Bob. That's the best part about it. So he's personalising mine, hopefully, with a number 9 and a Wycombe badge. That'd be even better.
Cheers, folksy. Back to Dr. Bob. On another note altogether, I was asked recently in an interview with the Wycombe Wanderers fanzine if I could take 3 members of the squad with me on a pub quiz. Who would they be? You were one of them, Bob, so I'm going to put you on the spot here. What's the capital of Luxembourg?
Oh, goodness me, you've got me there. I'd say it's Luxembourg, isn't it?
Correct. This has vindicated my decision. Fantastic. Bob, it's great to chat to you for Ringing the Blues, and we wish you all the best with your Smart Armour shin pad.
It's a real pleasure, Phil. Keep up the great work, because I've always been a big fan. I'll continue to be.
Top man. Big up Dr. Bob Sangar. Great story and a great bloke. Right, on to Pride Park then. Wycombe Wanderers taking on their old friends, Derby County. Toby Large joined us on comms. Here's what happened. Mometi, left wing now, he's away, he's inside the box, goes past one, still going, Mometi, still going, and scores! And it's Mometi, does it again, dancing it off the left-hand side, he brushes past defenders like they don't exist, and then pops it in the bottom corner for his fifth goal of the season. And it's Mometi, he's writing his name in lights in League One this season. Wycombe Wanderers lead here at Pride Park, Derby nil, Wycombe 1.
I feel like I'm saying the same thing every single week. We watch the same goal for him. He skips past one, he skips past two, fires it in at the near post. And it's just becoming the most common thing ever for Wycombe. I can't believe what I'm watching from this kid.
McGoldrick on the left-hand side. Squares it, finds Hurrahane. Shot comes in and scores! There's the equaliser, the left foot of Conor Hurrahane. And Max Striak is finally beaten. Goal coming on 71 minutes. Derby County 1, Wycombe Wanderers 1.
Well, that is as good of a goal as we are going to be able to see in this league. That's absolutely excellent football from Derby. Played it to the edge of the box to Conor Hurrahane, and well, he'd been given just too much time. And right on the stroke of the end of the national anthem that the Derby fans had been singing, they kind of teed that off with Conor Hurrahane finding the top corner. That was a brilliant finish. His left foot into the top left corner, and things are all square here once again. And Wycombe maybe just need to try and come at them now. Definitely not game over, and the 3 points are still there to fight for.
It's a ball into Barkhuizen, then Collins with a good flick, but McCarthy with a brutal tackle, but it breaks to Hurrahane. Now cashing on the left wing. Derby once more, cross comes in, it's driven across, punched away by Strick. Belendez Lang is in the area still, onto his left. Can he get a shot away? He can't. Sibley gets a shot in, and then it's beaten away. Hurrahane scores! Hurrahane at the double for Derby County. Wycombe couldn't clear their lines, and they were leading, but Derby have pegged them back, and with 5 minutes to go, they get in the lead. Derby County 2, Wycombe Wanderers 1.
Yeah, I think based on this second half, it's probably a deserved lead for Derby County. They've been the more attacking of the two sides, and you felt like it might have been coming.
Defeat on the road then for Wycombe Wanderers, and some of those Derby fans were very happy indeed on the final whistle. Here's the opposition view, part two. CFC Pete.
Wycombe are some right shithouse anti-football merchants, and the ref was spineless with it too. What a striking difference between them and that Plymouth side who came and took the game to us, and got a win by the way. Terrible team. Football won the day today.
Potsick.
So happy we beat that load of scummers. That's what happens if you do a Ronaldo-like celebration at 1-0 up in the 15th minute and then proceed to time waste for the next 75. Morons. Back to London you go. Good riddance.
Stephen Pickering.
A well-deserved win for the boys today. A shocking opening 25 matured into some of the best football we've played this season. Battered them. Finally, a second half that showed we do possess, or at least attaining, the required level of fitness too.
Dean Clark.
That game today was exactly what I've been expecting from League One. A horrible, long ball team consistently slowing the game down. That's Wycombe. Well done, our boys.
Tom.
Whew, we're lucky we're in League One with performances like today's. Any half-decent championship team would have put us to bed very early in the first half. Luckily, we can get away with it at this level.
Andrew won.
For me, the first 20 to 25 was shockingly poor. They are a poor side, and we actually made them look above average. After that, things improved, only slightly, until half-time. The real turning point was the introduction of Collins and Mendes Lang. He had their fullback on toast, and the changes in formation did the trick. Horrible little club, horrible manager, and horrible chairman. Couldn't have turned out better.
Gemma Marie.
so fitting that just as God Save the King rang out across the only football ground opened by the Queen, Horahan equalised today.
Gordon Williams.
Can we be sued for scoring more goals than them?
Right, that's it off for this week. Many thanks to Gareth Ainsworth, Max Striek, Dr. Bob Sanger, and also to Wycombe Sound and Landways for all their hard work in making it possible to do commentaries now from the newly named Bill Turnbull Gantry at Adams Park. We'll be back next week with news of the Papa John's game against Stevenage and our trip to Sheffield Wednesday. In the meantime, come on, you Blues.